All right, let's move into Queensland's election result, the crushing defeat on Saturday night for the LNP leader Deb Frecklington, announcing today that she'll now resign as party leader.
Once all of the results are finally declared, I will convene a party room meeting and I will ask my colleagues to appoint a new leader of the Liberal National Party. I will not be a candidate in the leadership contest.
Now, the announcement that she will now go comes less than 48 hours after she declared on election night, on Saturday night, that she would stay as opposition leader in a pretty ungracious concession speech, but I'll get to that point in just a moment. Joining me now, Courier-Mail's State Affairs Editor, Steve Wardill, from Brisbane. Steve, I don't think it's surprising that she would go. I thought it was incredibly surprising that she said she would stay on Saturday night. But I just want to make a point. I know it was brought up by Alan Jones in the broadcast. I found it absolutely unbelievable that when the Premier was speaking, she would go out, and I have to put it down to her being poorly advised. I don't think she would be that stupid. But she went out for her concession speech at the same time. And I want to say to people at home, what normally happens, the chiefs of staff of both the incumbent and the one trying to win, we have each other's numbers. And so you organise for, you know, if you've lost, you organise for your boss to call the victor, to congratulate them and to concede, and it's all done in an orderly way. I was embarrassed about how badly it was handled by the LNP on Saturday night.
Yeah, I think you're being a bit kind to Deb Frecklington there, Peter. I thought, poorly advised or not, she should have realised that the appropriate thing to do was to call Anastasia Palaszczuk, get out there and concede when it was clearly obvious the LNP wasn't going to come anywhere near a majority or a minority, and allow her moment to, accept her third victory. Instead, we had this kind of calamitous scenario of the two of them up at the same time. I know that the journalists in Anastasia's room had been warned that she was coming out soon, but the journalists at the LNP party hadn't been told anything. So all of a sudden, that they're watching Anastasia Palaszczuk, and out on the stage came Deb Frecklington. Clearly, the other kind of error she made was declaring that she would stay on as leader, as if there would be no contest for the position. Now, you know as good as anyone, Peter, that there has to be a contest after an election loss like that. The roles get thrown open, the party room gets to decide whether you stay or go. And clearly she'd made the assumption that she thought the numbers were pretty safe. And over the last couple of days, she's found out that they've slipped away very, very quickly.
And look, even when you win, you have to reconvene the party room. And even when you've been elected, you know, when you're leading the party, you've suddenly become Prime Minister. You're not Prime Minister until your party room votes you back in as leader, and then you go out there and get sworn in and all the other things that come from that. So I found it was all pretty extraordinary. And it maybe was the metaphor for how disorganised the campaign was under the ground. Who will replace her?
I think it'll definitely be David Crisafulli at the moment. He seems to be the front runner. He's the member for Broadwater. He's a former Townsville MP and minister in the Newman government who shifted down to the Gold Coast after a term out of Parliament. He's very well regarded, particularly in the business section. I think the LNP headquarters think he could attract a lot more money, a lot more support there. So I'd say it would probably be him. I think Tim Mander, Deb Frecklington's deputy, will probably put his hand up. But my guess is, from talking to MPs, that the view is that he probably held hands with Deb Frecklington over the cliff here, and it was a pretty horrendous result for the LNP, and it's probably time for new people in both the leader and deputy positions.
All right, well, talk to me about the minor party. Talk to me about One Nation. There's a lot of talk that their vote went back to Labor on Saturday night. That accords with my view. You know, I've long held the view that there's quite... I mean, it differs booth to booth, electorate to electorate, but there's quite a significant Labor vote, old Labor, if I could call it that, not the modern green hard left, in the One Nation vote. It's an amalgam of Conservative and Labor voters, and they went back home, if I can call it that. Is that your view? And what does this say for whether or not Pauline Hanson at a federal level is likely to go around again?
Yeah, look, I think Pauline's collapse here was about 7% across the state. But you have to remember she did very well in the 2017 election, and I don't think this state election was really one for minor parties. Like people are talking about how well the Greens did in inner Brisbane. That's true. But their statewide vote also went backwards. Clive's went nowhere. The Katter Australia Party were pretty flat as well. This was a flight to the major parties. Both of them mm-hmm. received a pretty good bump. The problem for the LNP was that the Labor Party got a much bigger bump. The swing to them was something like 4.7%. And I'm glad you said that about old Labor voters, Peter, because I think you're 100% right. I think when you look at where the swing away from One Nation was and how it split heavily towards the Labor Party, I think that is that blue-collar vote returning home, particularly in places like central Queensland. It's also older voters as well, older voters in seats like Palmerstone and Caloundra and Hervey Bay. They really swung towards the Labor Party and weren't particularly on the LNP's radar as problems until very late in the campaign. So I think it's that message that Anastasia was pushing relentlessly about, I'm going to keep the borders closed and I'm going to keep you safe. And that just played well with those One Nation voters and played well with those older voters.
Now, please make my day and tell me this will be the end of Clive Palmer. $8 million he put in and he only achieved about 13,000 votes. Is he going to, you know, take his bat and ball and go home?
I'd love to make your day, Peter, but I'm not convinced. We've got a picture in the paper today of two former LNP presidents on the boat on Clive's super yacht with him on election day. The optics for the LNP could not be worse. I reckon that photo will last forever and a day to link the LNP to Clive Palmer, and I just don't think he's had enough. Obviously, his death tax scare campaign fell flat. You know, the highest number that any of his candidates got was about 420 votes, and he ran in, mm-hmm. I think it was 60-odd seats in the end. Like, he really achieved nothing here but wasted all that money, and it probably was a distraction that the LNP didn't need.
Yeah, but just on that point, and I 100% agree with you, ever since Clive Palmer, he has a long history in the National Party, but ever since he's been tied up in the LNP and its rebirthed merged form, it's never going to survive because of all the hangovers to the people that are half with him and on his boards and his play in all of this. The LNP, if it ever wants to get into power, has got to have a top-to-bottom clean-out, doesn't it?
Yeah, I agree with you there as well. I remember when the LNP was formed and at the first election they were considering going around the state in Clive Palmer's big jet with mineralogy printed on the side of it. And I think some bright spark came to the conclusion pretty quickly that that was not going to be a good idea. So they decided to tell Clive that they didn't need his plane and they'd find a plane somewhere else. And I think a lot of people in the LNP have to come to the same conclusion. You know, you had this bizarre scenario not too long ago when the LNP president in Queensland had decided to take a bit of a part-time job working for a consultant with Clive. Like, can you imagine
Absolutely.
A scenario where a Labor Party president is out kind of, you know, dining with Bob Brown? Like, that, it's the same equivalent on the other side. That you would never find the Labor Party doing something like that. And it's got to... I think people in the LNP have got to come to the realisation that Clive is as much of the enemy as what the Labor Party is.
I think too many people are too interested in the money, and if they don't want to be loyal to the LNP, I think they should be shown the door. Steve Waddell, thank you for your time.
Thanks, Peter.